call the meeting to order here in just a second. Let's go ahead and call the Talent City Council meeting to order of May 3rd. Roll call, please.
Councilor Kumar.
Here.
Councilor Kumar.
Here.
Councilor Driver is not present. Councilor Espinosa is not present. Councilor Byers.
Here.
Here.
Mayor Peterson.
Here.
Mayor Duhalde.
And for the record, Councilor Mestiza. All right, so the next item on the agenda is additions and corrections to agenda. Anybody have any additions or corrections to the agenda? Councilor Clark?
Yeah, I would like to add irrigation infrastructures to support future tree planting as 9.2.
Any objections? All right. Item 9.2 is irrigation for trees. Can we?
Sure.
For notes?
Yep.
Okay. And 9.2 is new business. Any other additions or corrections? All right. So without objection, we'll make that change to 9.2 and move on to item number 3, which is community announcements. Steph?
Great, thank you. Up on the screen in front of you or the packet ahead of you, and I'll invite you to come sit next to me in case you have any questions about these. We have coming up Wildfire Community Preparedness Day. We're letting staff have the cozy seats tonight, what we're doing. Oh, you can come sit down.
Oh, absolutely.
We've got a local folks market at Wagon Plaza, Talent Business Mixer at Talent Makers City on the 10th, a big craft crawl on the 13th. That sounds like it's going to be a really fun, almost harvest festival like size event. And then Talent Evening Market starts on the 25th, and we've gone throughout the summer. And just to add that they're going to try and do meetings in the park this year as well. So get ready for that and this new summer weather. And you guys want to add some trees?
I do apologize, Councilman Clark. You had reminded us that there will be a Greenway meeting on May 3rd. That's today. That should be up on the list. So, yes.
Because anyone who's here can't make it over there, so.
And I just want to add, on May 20th, we'll have the first of a 5 concert series. It's free. It's at the Commons Park. And from 6 to 8, please bring your family. It's family friendly. We encourage you to bring a picnic. We'll be working with local restaurants to work out some picnic offerings at restaurants, but also bring something from home. And our first show is a jazz show from
Brookings.
Brookings, yeah.
Django.
Yeah. Doing Django Reinhardt turns. I'm really excited about that. Any other? I think I saw some hands triggering to go up. Anybody else? All right. So that 5-part series is one concert a month, by the way. So keep your eye open with Talent Business Lines. All right. Next item on the agenda is speakers heard on non-agenda items. I have 2 request forms. Gary Pendergast. Did I get that right? Pendergast? Come on up. Please step up to the microphone and state your name and your city for the record.
My name is Gary Pendergast. I've lived here on Foss Road in Talent since 1978, so you can do the math. My topic for being here tonight is the terrible condition of the road, surface, and speaking with Public Works, they said they're aware of it, but that it's on the list. And so I was showing up tonight to see if there's anything that can be done to prioritize it, to move it up the list, because it really is bad. I don't know if any of you drive the road very often, but my big concern, I guess, is all the school bus traffic in that section. And I'm just kind of amazed, happy, and glad that there hasn't been an accident there yet in that section, because driving there through there so often, I see so many times with the huge potholes going the west direction. There, if there's two cross traffic coming at the same time, people aren't smart enough to slow down and wait for one person to come through. And you know, you got big trucks, pickups, I have nothing against pickups, by the way, but that just plow through those potholes, and I think it's a real big safety concern. And so that's why I'm expressing my concerns. I was told the old adage, the squeaky wheel gets the you know what, and so I'm here to provide the squeak, and that's it. Any questions?
Mr. Pendergast, when we're on an agenda item, we don't discuss the items until later in the agenda,
okay.
So we'll
all
have
right.
an opportunity to discuss it on item number 10, which
okay.
is kind of later in the evening.
Okay.
If you want to hang out for that,
okay.
I'm happy to bring it up. We have talked about it quite a bit lately, so.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Great.
Well, there's nothing else. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Pendergast.
Okay.
Okay, next speaker, Mr. Lutz, please come forward and state your name and city for the record.
Thank you. Okay, my name is Chris Lutz. I live just outside the city of Talent, the city of Phoenix. I live in the Phoenix Talent School District and Fire District 5. We still doing 5 minutes, guys?
Yes.
Okay, great.
Have you got, will somebody get the time? It sounds like we're going to need the timer.
Yeah, we're going to read it to try 5 minutes. So my comments are intended for those that will listen to this meeting at a later date. Please share my comments. Ballot measure 15216 is not a fire recovery plan. Thank you to the people of Talent for speaking out against ballot measure 15216, the proposed urban renewal plan, and for standing up against the misinformation being peddled by Mayor Darby on social media, on radio, and at council meetings. Special thanks to Gravel Pizzeria, the Phoenix Town School District, and Jackson County for opposing
proposals. I have a point of order, Chris. 1 second. Please stop the time. Yeah.
So technically, this is on the agenda. There's a written communication to this effect, and this is relevant, which we've all read. So this is basically any available public record. This seems to be a rehash of that. So I would say it's redundant and not really an agenda item because it's already kind of a written communication. So I'd like to just skip it if possible.
Any objections?
Not in the agenda packet.
It's item number 11.1. If there's no objections, we'll ask you to take a seat, and I'll put 11.1 on your.
So can I speak at 11.1?
Yeah.
All right. Thank you. Are you at?
Yeah. It was actually, I think it was written communications, which is what I meant. It is a written communication that's already part of the public record, so it is on the agenda, and this is just kind of getting double time for the same information. So that was my point. Written communications. I'm not aware that it's also on the agenda, but maybe it is.
I understand. That's a good point, but it is on the agenda.
I thought that was number 10, that's why I was
confused. No, that's other, yeah. All right, so I'll go ahead and take that speaker request form back. I don't think it's gonna be a long meeting.
Okay.
Yeah. Or then have a seat.
Agenda item again?
11:29.
All right, I'll be back, thank you.
Councilor Tanner?
So 11.1 is written communications. We generally don't discuss that. So my point was not that he should be allowed to speak and essentially read his written communications, but that rather the written communication is the communication of the information that he's attending from twice into the agenda. So, okay, there wouldn't be a, there would not, my understanding is there would not be an opportunity for Mr. Lez to speak.
Okay, Mr. Lez, do you want to take up a different item besides your written communication, which is already on record? I'll certainly give you that opportunity.
So, which item do you want to speak about this under?
A non-agenda item that is not the written communication, because your written communication is already on record.
Correct. So, in every city council meeting going in the future, if you write something in the city council, you can't talk about that?
It's actually in our council rules.
What I have is different than what's in the written communication.
I'm sorry?
What I have is different than what's in the council packet or in the written communication I sent to Lucero.
Oh, so what you're speaking on is not your written communication.
What I'm speaking on is this, what I'm about to read is different than the stuff I sent you.
So, okay, I just want to make sure I'm clear because I want to understand. You have a letter on the record, and you're not reading that letter.
That's correct.
Okay. Let's go ahead and get this timer started and pick up where you are.
Present. Okay, are you ready? So my comments are intended for those that will listen to this meeting at a later date. Please share my comments. Ballot measure 15216 is not a fire recovery plan. Thank you to the people of Talent for speaking out against ballot measure 15216, the proposed urban renewal plan, and for standing up against the misinformation being peddled by Mayor Garvey on social media, on radio, and at council meetings. Thanks to the Gravel Pizza, RIA, Phoenix Talent School District, and Jackson County for opposing the proposed urban renewal plan. Thank you also to the Nurses Union members for knocking on doors in Talent to inform voters about reasons to vote no on this measure.
1 second. Mr. Lutz is reading verbatim his written communication.
This is different.
It's the same.
It's not.
You're reading it.
It's not.
I see the words on the paper.
It's not.
That's what I was trying to see. Okay. So let's go ahead and move on to item 5.1 is resolution of 2023-063-R, amending the Parks Master Plan to include the Labyrinth and Chuck Roberts Park. Staff report?
Mayor, are we going to speak again or am I done?
We'll take it up on other. Yeah.
Thank you.
We'll review the rules.
All right.
Yeah, thank you, Mayor. So resolution 2023-063-R would amend the Parks Master Plan to include a labyrinth in Chuck Roberts Park as a plan improvement. This topic comes up from our last council meeting in which council reviewed a Parks Commission recommendation to place a labyrinth in the park. This year is under the public hearing here tonight, just to be able to highlight it for the community that wants to speak on it before it comes to the deliberates. Yes, Mayor, one more clarification I'd love to make for you all is this resolution just amends the master plan. The actual design, location, et cetera, would come before council at a future date if this project were to be adopted and then move forward towards implementation.
Is that the staff report? Okay. And is there any part of the presentation? Or is this just this?
It's just this.
I saw everybody look up and I'm like,
no, sorry. Yeah. This just gives my opinion to the audience.
Okay. Are there any questions for staff? Council Phenomenal.
So I'm just gonna make sure I understood. I've been thinking about the location and thinking maybe that's not the best place, maybe there should be some more thought process. There would be an opportunity for that thought process later on, even if we adopted the resolution here.
All this resolution does is on the Chuck Roberts part of the Parks Master Plan. It adds as a line item a labyrinth as a plan improvement. It does not state location, size, or any of those details.
Potential follow-up is that there was a nice report prepared by Parks, so that won't be incorporated by reference into the master plan. It will just be a line item.
Correct. I'll go ahead and show you what the change in the master plan would look like. Correct. That concept was just added as reference to the staff report,
okay.
Not to the Parks amendment.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Yeah. Councilor Park?
Yeah, I did. Read the resolution and to your point about the location and the size not being spelled out in the resolution, there was a little disconnect in my mind as I think that to amend it, you know, to amend it to add a feature, the location of that feature is a paramount consideration. All of the other, I believe all the other features. Maybe not, there might be some exceptions, but describing the master plan, you know, are depicted with their proposed location, you know, with consideration of how that feature affects other surrounding features. And, yeah, I just had a question. If the location is not determined, then is that really a fully baked amendment?
Yeah, this topic came up last city council meeting. We really, the question was made, what amounts to amendment or not amendment? And we recognize that we wanted to create some standards to better define what that is. You know, for the standards that I would recommend, and this is for a conversation for a later date, my recommendation is if the use of the park has changed, or we add a park acreage, that necessitates an amendment. A lot of them doesn't technically change the usage of the Chuck Norris Park area, and so I would make the point that this maybe would rise the need for an actual full parks amendment to the plan. So that being said, what we're doing now, I'll go ahead and show it, so I think it will help. While the Parks Master Plan has concept maps within the master plan, those concept maps are not the set in stone. For example, if you remember in the now footprint of Patrick Park, there was a play structure earmarked in that concept plan. When we finally had enough money to implement the legislation facing that play structure, we came before council and said, hey, there's two locations we could potentially put it in. The one over on the west end and the one over on the east end. And we had a discussion and made a determination at that point. So I think it's important to recognize that the maps in the plan are concepts, but they're not the final for sure location of things.
Thank you.
And I will say I intentionally have made this amendment not to adopt the actual physical location, just to allow more design flexibility and conversation, since this is a new addition to what we're doing for Chuck Roberts Park.
Thank you.
Yeah. Any other questions?
Okay. I appreciate, I do want to express my appreciation to staff for adding on this process. And I know that we're getting to work creating criteria to follow to make sure that we don't miss amendments to the park, et cetera. And I also really value the work that you guys are doing, so I want to thank you for that. All right, so if there's no further I have a speaker request form on this one. Charlie Cross, please come forward and state your name and city for the record. Councilor Nomar?
Yeah. If this is a public hearing, I'm just supposed to read something.
Or
a public English.
I talked to our attorney, Gabe Lundin, about this, and he said that resolutions do not require for public hearings, so just having it on the agenda counts as a public hearing itself. But if you want to, you can formally open and then close if so desired.
It's been notified. That's right. Okay. I don't see any reason to do that. Unless Johnson wants me to open here. Okay. All right.
Charlie Cross, City of Talent, and I'm here as the chair of the Parks Commission. When I sent in the speaker request, I remember this came up at the last city council meeting, whether I had to do that or not, since I'm kind of here in an official capacity. So I don't really have anything new to say. Jordan nailed almost everything I was going to say in response to what Councilor Clark asked about. So really, I'm offering myself if you guys want any further clarification of Parks and Rec's views on this proposed amendment. I'm here to answer questions and be helpful.
Any questions? Councilor Clark?
Yeah, a couple of questions for anyone who knows. The side of the proposed size has a 40-foot diameter. That's 1,256 square feet. A 30-foot diameter circle is 56% of that area, only 707 square feet. And I was wondering how the determination of the 40-foot diameter was arrived at in the proposal, and if that could be reduced for the sake of making it easier to fit into space and significantly less area to maintain.
So I'm not able to speak on what the design, how the design came about. Charlie may have some more insight, but I will say if this amendment is approved and it is earmarked as a future project for Chuck Roberts Park, the next step that I requested of a community member who would like to take the lead in helping make this happen is that they meet with the public works staff to discuss concerns, to develop the design together, and ultimately that design will have to go through the Parks Commission first. Parks Commission will make a recommendation to City Council for the approval of the design and location of the labyrinth. And I do know the individual working on it. I'm sure we'll be happy to also meet kind of further discussions with the council on it during that design process.
Okay.
Yeah, but Troy, I would love to look to you if you know any more about design.
Maybe just a smidge. I believe that the 40-foot diameter came from looking at other kind of typical labyrinths in similar public spaces. And I think that's a fairly common size for these things. I also know that when Ted Hilton Walker looked at this in the context of Chuck Roberts Park with Robert Slayton from Public Works, that Robert had no problem with that size. It fit. The spot that was shown in the concept diagram seemed to work well. It worked well with irrigation issues in the park and things like that. So everybody seemed to feel that 40 feet was good. Again, as Jordan said, this doesn't nail down the specifics of the design. So if it turns out later on that a smaller 30-foot one, to follow your example, fits better or whatever, that's certainly open for discussion.
It sounds to me like anybody that would have any input on design or location would be able to submit their comments to Parks, because they're going to hear it first, or wait till it comes to council for the design piece of it, right? Does that sound right? Okay. That was sort of rhetorical to see if you wanted to maybe submit your comments to the parks when they get to work on the design.
Uh-huh, sure.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Councilor Penamis?
Yeah, I'll just add that I think this will be a lovely addition to the park. I can see people really enjoying it. I kind of share the idea of perhaps a smaller would fit in better with the park. And I would just, I think that it would be great as Parks mulls these things over to think holistically. You know, the tennis courts, whether that can stay there, the eventual playground for children with disabilities to be able to play, whether, you know, all of those things kind of in a context. It would also be really nice to see some, options presented to the community of a holistic nature and kind of like visioning workshops like we do in the community center to just kind of get lots of points of view and buy-in from the community. So, thanks.
So do you want to carry some of the comments? I mean, I don't want to, like, if you have more comments, Councillor Clark, I don't want to suggest that you have to do that. It sounds to me like Councillor Penomarev is giving some comments to Charlie to carry on. Is there any that you want to make?
Sure. So like I said, I think it could potentially be smaller than 40 feet diameter. I'm concerned about the location as being a place that people already hang out on the grass there in proximity to the other features. I think there's potential for before it to be disturbed by being so close to the playground area. I think there would be trade-offs associated with that anyway. I wonder if there, you know, could be a more quiet contemplative location that's outside of the hustle and bustle. I've heard some constituents suggest that they would like to have more more games and recreational opportunities in that little part of the park, and would having a labyrinth in that location preclude or provide a conflicting conflicting use due to the proximity. The proposal to leave the installation to a volunteer effort concerns me. And I'm also concerned about maintenance, and if we, you know, as a city determine that this is something that we want, then perhaps we should be prepared to pay to have it installed professionally. And I know volunteers can do great work, but and do in the city all the time, but the accountability piece is difficult when you're talking about, a feature of this substance and this level of, for heavy equipment, yards and yards of gravel, decomposed granite, large rocks. This is a big project. This is not going out for weeks for the day. And by the way, I'm concerned about people going out for weeks for the day. 1,200 square feet of decomposed granite and rocks will produce a lot of weeds that have to be handled. I feel confident that there's space for labyrinth in this park. I think they're beautiful, but I'm feeling like there's a lot of details that deserve deeper consideration.
Councilor Myers? To Councilor Clark's points, those are all absolutely reasonable and understandable. And I'm just curious, I don't think this resolution states any sort of promise or commitment to making sure that that outline scenario is the scenario that happens when the labyrinth comes to grace our park. So I guess I'm curious if I'm missing something in this resolution that is stating with greater specificity the process of installing the labyrinth.
Yeah, I think what happened was I allowed for two councilors to offer some notes to the planning chair to take back as notes in the as you guys design and consider this. I think it'll cut time out. That's what I think will happen.
Great.
And make it more expedient so it doesn't bounce back and forth. Yeah. And I don't think it takes off the table also. And it takes off the table any like written notes or written suggestions that any councilman brought to make to the Parks Department. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Maybe I should have pointed that towards the liaison at the end. But
no.
But Charlie said he was here to
he's
here to
feedback was great to hear, sorry to some years of rather than one. I guess I was still focused on like, oh, are we looking at this resolution in this moment?
I may have been too liberal and I took Charlie up on his offer to, to be here to help.
Okay.
Anyway, I think we're okay. Thank you, Charlie, for taking notes. I do think that hearing some of the things that you guys can address when you're, we'll save time by getting it this way. So that's my note anyway, by allowing it. Any other, Councilor?
Yeah, I just got my notes kind of scattered in different places and just saw another thing. When it comes to determining the location, I'd be curious to hear from a broader, or to know that a broader spectrum of the community had a chance to consider that and wondered if a survey like in the TNR, I think there was something recently pertaining to dog park or dogs in parks that was in there, something similar to this that everyone would have a chance to see, and an email if you have thoughts, send an email here. I would just like to know that everybody has a chance to consider this because this is a good start.
I said something similar at the last meeting, and for me, it's about like notification, which I think, and we've had conversations along the week about the same thing, and
Charlie and I have this one.
Yeah, so it sounds like we're all kind of treating on the same thing, I think our comment with each other was it's not either or, but it's both. Mm-hmm. For me, the threshold, simply for me, the threshold is public notification. That's old dog, 20 years service. But Parks has a reputation of going above and beyond that. I appreciate the comment about the survey as well, and you had mentioned that earlier. Sounds like you guys are talking about it as well. Please go ahead. We don't have a big agenda here, so I'm being a little liberal, which is the prerogative of the chair. So.
I'm too tall for this mic stand. A clarifying question. I'm all about surveys and public input and all that kind of stuff, and I think our track record shows that's more than just words. What I want to clarify on Jason's suggestion that we seek, do a survey or something on pinning down the location of the labyrinth is if we adopt this amendment, this becomes another line item in the Chuck Roberts plan, and there's line items in the plans for each of the other parks. Under what circumstances, as we begin to actually do a line item in any given park, whichever line item, whichever park, do we always seek that public input? Or are there guidelines that you guys can give me to help Parks Commission know this one is one where we should get public input, that playground over there, that's just routine. So I'm fuzzy on where that boundary is.
Yeah, I mean, my input was just what it was, and it remains. For me, it's about public notification, and it's why I appreciate that we are starting to take a process when we're making changes to the park, because with that comes public notification where everybody has the opportunity. They may not come forward, but everybody knows, has the opportunity to know that these things are happening. So again, that just might be my years of service that when there's public amenities changed or amendments to plans, public notification comes with that, which is really why I want to see more of these public processes happen, because with that comes the public notice. But I appreciate the point. I appreciate the point that that Parks has always gone above. You guys have had tables at the evening markets, and I remember when I was on Parks, we did Goots every year at the Harvest Festival, and so at minimum for me, in my input is at minimum there should be public notice on all plan amendments or changes to public space. And like I said, that comes with hearings. So. Or takes care of itself. With that said, though, I think to
Clark's point, the survey that you did in the TNR on the dog park, we've done stuff like that in the past as well. I think that's really effective. Gives everybody a second opportunity. So I don't want to invalidate your point by saying what concerns me is public notice. Yeah. Any other input on that?
Just this is fantastic that we had this like ongoing conversation about how to improve process and clarifying the point at the minimum, which is public hearing and following through that process, and then you know exploring the other opportunities to welcome input. I think I am looking forward to solidifying that checklist, that total of like, did we do this? All right. Next layer, we could do these things. How about this? So I'm looking forward to that point.
Sounds like it's getting get worked on. Is there any other comments or questions? All right. I appreciate the conversation, though I think it is heading us in the right direction. So thank you everybody for your input. So with that, I would entertain a motion. Councilor Byers.
I move to adopt resolution 2023-063-R.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to adopt 2023-063-R. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed?
Motion? Nay.
Okay. So motion carries. All right, the next item on the agenda is item 5.2. Resolution 2023-064-R. I'm going to stop this for a second. I'm sorry. I think it would be helpful, yep. Unless you don't want to speak to it.
No, I do. Yeah. I just skipped over the deliberation portion.
Did I skip over it? Did I ask for deliberation?
I did not speak up.
Oh, okay.
You did. All right. I said it, and I did not speak up.
Yeah.
My reservations are that I would feel more comfortable if more of the details were worked out in advance before we.
Okay.
That was the reason for my vote.
Yeah, that makes sense. Okay. I'm sorry if I didn't wait long enough for your deliberation.
No, I should speak up more quickly.
Yeah, no. I'm sorry.
Oh, quite all right.
All right, item 5.2 is resolution 2023-064-R, formerly naming the park along Creekside Way, Footprints Pathway. Staff?
Yes, so City Council, at our April 19th meeting, you all did pass by motion the approval of the renaming of the park along Creekside Way. In consultation with our attorney, who might be there, he recommended that we do pass a resolution, because it's a historical document that just helps track the record of our theory. So this is a resolution that really does exactly what you all passed last meeting, which would name the Creekside Way Park Footprints Pathway.
Any discussion, or excuse me, any questions? All right, seeing none, I will entertain a motion. Councilor Clark.
I move to adopt resolution 2023-064-R.
Second.
There's a motion and a second to adopt resolution 2023-064-R. Any discussion? Councilor Byers?
Yes, thank you. I totally say that while I support the adoption of this name, I still am strongly advocating for a lot more community and relationship building before we adopt any other signage for this park.
Okay, any other deliberations? Hearing none. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
messages from the hospital. My mother's in the hospital. So I'm going to step out and give you the gavel, okay? I need that. I just need to find out what's going on.
All right, moving on to item number 6.1, department reports.
Thank you, and I was not able to prepare a written report for you all, so I will walk through the section a little more slowly than people. I will make this first. Our longtime public works director, Brett Marshall, has accepted a position at another municipality. And so we will be working on that soon for the public works director, but we will miss Brett dearly, but wish him all the best for where he's going. I also want to say that we have a new intern with us for the summer to help Public Works Department do things it comes to maintenance, which we get the weeks at all of our parks. That is Michael, who's on day two. You should see Public Works out and about with their mowing, their weeding, and preparing for fire season. We've officially shifted into spring mode. And then, as the team is very excited about, we recently purchased an electric lawnmower as well as various other electrical equipment. People are having a lot of fun using them. I will say they're way more sophisticated than they were 5 years ago when we bought our last batch. And the other great news is that the city was awarded a portable power generator for use in emergency situations through the state's SPIRE program. So that's a great one of the emergency equipment needs that we had. In the event that a fire, earthquake, or other event happens, we'll need to bring a generator to the location.
Councilor.
Thanks. I'm just wondering, what is this fire program? What does it stand for? I'm also a little bit curious about the generator. Is it gasoline, propane, or I'm just curious about it.
Yes, and I apologize. I have written all this down on this paper. I left my office. This fire program is a statewide program that awards equipment to communities that's specific to emergency preparedness. The generator is a, I believe it's a propane generator, and it is large enough where it could make sure our water pumps continue to go. Not our main one, but the ones that we have throughout the city to help get water to houses at higher elevations. Yeah. So updates from our police department. Our police team has been doing coffee with the cop events, one a month in a different neighborhood. This last April, they met with Spring Garden residents, and they had 14 folks there and a really robust conversation. I also want to give a shout out to Ashlyn and our local police department. They have co-hosted FEMA training for all department heads and management across Ashlyn and Talent, so that we're looking a little more prepared for this fire season. Training is ongoing, and two of our officers under their own research received scholarships and attended a two-day Dewey multidisciplinary conference, which is great. Any questions on these?
Yeah. I'd love to know which officers attended that training in April.
The training in April. So we had three of our officers. It was Divya, Schwan, and Sanchez attended the crisis intervention training. That's required, I think, every 3 years training, and it's really focused on helping folks who are experiencing a mental health episode or around drugs, and how both officers and those individuals can stay safer through de-escalation tactics. And then for the sex trafficking, the ethics, and common ground conversation on race, that was the whole team.
Thank you.
Yeah. Community development, just so you know, we are currently interviewing applicants for our plan of operation. We are also having a lot of community meetings right now, both for our climate-friendly areas as well as the Bear Creek Highway United Revisioning Project. So we're looking forward to the outcome of those meetings in the next few months. And our community engagement department, the new website is now officially in beta testing, and I'll have to give you guys a spin through it, and we'll be sharing out that link for you guys to click through and break things as desired. I want to let you all know that Lucetto will be out of office for a month. So Hector will be filling the role of student reporter in her stead. And then the last thing I've got on the slide is that the city, in partnership with Jackson County and with the city of Phoenix, we were awarded a $1 million grant from the Oregon Fire Marshal to clean up some of the fallen debris in Bear Creek Reno. So we just learned about that this week, and we look forward to going as quickly as possible to start budgeting
all those fallen trees that came down in the windstorm.
Councilor Homer.
Yeah, I'm glad to see about the community meetings co-hosted. So that was the ones that were in the Talent Community Center that have been advertised. I'm just wondering if the City of Talent is doing smaller meetings and if those are being noticed. I'm just curious.
Yeah, so each meeting has its own flavor. So that one was a virtual meeting that we hosted in town. There's another meeting tonight in Phoenix, the one that Hector mentioned, that Bear Visioning Project. Kristen attended another meeting today that was specific to businesses and folks living in that specific area to talk about potential impacts through an equity lens. And then there was another regional meeting that was hosted in Medford that town attended as well.
Okay, great. So now I understand it was also the TGM grant, not just the clinic reference. Okay, great. Thank you.
Do you have one quick tour of the website?
I do apologize. There's a certain level of confidence I had in learning the new backend system to this website, and unfortunately that slowed me down. And once I was able to take the trainings, things are going a lot faster. This isn't what I was. No. Okay, there we go. So every time you go to the page, you'll see a different background photo. These are photos from Ezra Marcos, a local photographer. So if you were to control R on your keyboard or just simply refresh the page, you'll see a different photo. There being the Malibu Garage. On the left, you'll see the latest news segments. So weed abatement is a really big issue for us right now. Okay, beta testing. I'm sorry, that should have been all updated on the left. We should scroll through the top three most recent news segments. And if you remember on the old website, all the news is on the bottom left. And so there are people who call and say, hey, how come you guys never post any news? It's because, you know, simply scrolling down can be, it's not visually appealing or attractive to find out what you're looking for if you gotta click around. So on this website, it's gonna be prominent. And so your first three articles will scroll through on the left. And so that should have been updated, but I don't know what wrong. I probably forgot to save. And this does not look like my backend, so I do apologize. Let's see, that should, okay. Right. So for example, here's our Somos Talent information. I'm trying to get more people to go to the Somos outreach, especially the website and the social media.
And if you
want to
just hover over some of the top headings and then, you know, we'll let them explore on their own.
So the top, these are called your mega menus, so they would lead you through other parts of the website. And please feel free to, as Jordan had said earlier, click and break, and then send over any feedback.
Thank you, Hector.
I just have one question. Are there any pictures of the murals on there from Gateway?
I have a lot of those pictures, yes, but these are just examples. We can have up to 6 photos that rotate through. And I know the pictures along the fence.
Yeah, awesome. And so every time you land on a page, you'll land on a different.
Correct.
Yeah.
Oh, that showed up. That's weird.
Yes. Take a minute.
Yeah, so the top three that I've uploaded here, you see the weed abatement, then the next one is traffic safety, And after that would be your budget, which is coming up soon.
It's really lovely. I really like the news and everything, and I'm really looking forward to it. So I'm wondering now that you've had some training and you're more familiar with the back end, is the steps forward necessary to complete clear to you? And do you have an idea of what those are and how long do you expect to see?
Absolutely. I don't see myself taking any more than probably 3 or 4 days. Thank you, Minico.
The other picture you showed on there with the mural, and where is that artwork? Where did you get that artwork? It's beautiful. Mm-hmm.
So all the photography that you saw on the page is from Ezra, and we had him come in one afternoon when it was really nice and sunny, and he walked around town, took photos, and then came back and gave them to me. So I didn't ask him exactly where which one it was. We could put that up.
One of them was kind of like there was a piece of the mural that's out in front of.
This is Melody Garage across from Town Club.
Yeah.
I'm sure no one's been to the Town Club.
It's not this one. I love this one.
This is in front of Pump House.
Yeah. There was another one.
Mayor, I think it's on the side of the gym park.
Sorry, I just had to
hit the little circle button.
Okay, thank you.
Oh yeah, that's on the side of the gym emporium.
Yeah, there was that one, but there was one other one. I think it only
cycles it through three.
Okay, there was another image up there that was just beautiful.
And then there's also the one that's the mural at the end of the closet.
Part of it was on there. Yeah. There was another piece of art that it was attached to. No, it took up the whole screen. Anyway, I don't want to hold this up. It was beautiful. It had pear orchards in the background. Mm-hmm. And did you see it? Yeah. I've never seen that before, and it's beautiful.
You're talking about the mural that's on the side closer to the malt store in Biscuits and Milo?
Yeah, it looked like it was two pieces of two different murals.
I'll follow up with that to see if
you can get that. Yeah,
because that
was really good. And very representative of the community and across all the community. Nice job. Okay. Was that where were we? Was that 6.1? Is there more?
No.
Okay.
Device, and if that actually comes to fruition, it would be a really nice goodbye to our city that he spent so many years working for. So
absolutely. And then we'll take out that he gives you full credit for the roundabout idea.
But that's a lot. I said, Asia, how about a one-way street right here? And he's like,
I know this is a staff thing, but I hope that it's some sort of send off a member to the
will. Yeah, it was 19 years in the city.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
I'll just say, I think he's going to like his community a lot better.
Yes. Yes, he did. Yeah, Brett lives in Prospect, so it's a power drive to town.
Yeah. Okay, so we're on sub. Is that right? Thank you for that, Councilor Cromwell, picking up where I missed. Well, appreciate it. Item number 7 is 7.1 and 7.2 is the consent calendar. Are there any questions or comments about the consent calendar? Councilor Perry Miller.
This is not a substantive change, but just that the study session and the regular session were in person, not Zoom.
Other? Okay. So I'll entertain a motion to adopt a consent calendar. Councilor Byers?
I move to adopt the consent calendar with a suggested change by Councilor Brayman.
Second. We have a motion and a second to adopt the consent calendar. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, motion carries. I'm going to ask the council to indulge my family concern before I leave. If we had gone to item number 10 before I had to leave, I would have asked the council to relax the rules, which suggests that written communications don't get read into the record. Because of the sensitivity of the political climate right now and what would probably be more misinformation and blowback for us upholding council rules and not taking the written record or the written communications read into the record, I'm not interested in that. I'd rather hear what Chris has to say. It seems to be directed at me, if it has anything to do with this letter, before I go. So I'm going to leave. I'm going to give you your 5 minutes, and then I'm going to go. So please step up to the microphone, state your name and city, and read your letter, unless there's objections from the council. Councilor Palmer?
Chris, I'd just like to explain the nature of my objection, if I can. Unless you need to go.
No?
Okay.
I mean, I do need to go, but I have 15 minutes.
I'll just say that the purpose of, municipalities are not required by public meeting law to allow our community to come forward with topics, but like many cities, we do. And this is a chance for our constituents and interested folks to speak to the council. It's part of the business meeting. By preparing a written communication to this council, that has been communicated. But from the beginning of the former mayor of Davidson's speech, he made it clear that he wanted this to be listened to by other people, not particularly concerned about this council that already has received the information. And I just don't like to see a business meeting of the Talent City Council subverted to become somebody's personal podcast for a political agenda. So that was the nature of my objection. But saying that, I understand that you feel strongly, and I do support your decision to let him speak.
I don't feel strongly about it. If you want to entertain a motion, I know the movement that Mr. Lowe's is making, and I just don't need to entertain. I don't have the emotional economy tonight to entertain a whole bunch of nonsense. So if you want to read your letter, and then I'll leave the council to.
But Madam Mayor, I think the
go
council.
Go attend to my family business.
The council rules are being referred to the council, not reading into the record or discussing written communication. So when you look at
Mr. Laws, read your letter. Read
okay,
your
thank
letter.
You. Okay, well, my comments are intended for those that will listen to this meeting at a later date. Please
yes,
share.
Yeah.
Ready? Okay, my comments are intended for those that will listen to this meeting at a later date. Please share my comments. Ballot measure 15216 is not a fire recovery plan. Thank you to the people of town for speaking out against the ballot measure, the proposed renewal plan, and for standing up against the misinformation being peddled by Mayor Darby on social media, on radio, and at council meetings. Special thanks to Grotto Pizzeria, the Phoenix Talent School District in Jackson County, for opposing the proposed renewal plan. Thank you also to the Nurses Union members for knocking on doors in Talent to inform voters about reasons to vote no on this measure. Special thanks for our firefighters and fire chief for standing in opposition to the proposed urban renewal scheme. It has been disheartening to see on social media and hear on the radio demeaning and disrespectful comments made by Mayor Darby about the men and women who fought the Illinois fire to save much of our communities. Our first responders do not have a hidden agenda, as you claim. They just want the best for the district and their communities. The defamation you have been leveling toward our firefighters is discouraging. The so-called Fire Recovery and Resiliency Plan is not a fire recovery plan and would have nothing to do with fire recovery. Mayor Darby claims that a yes vote will provide rebuilding money now for fire recovery. The claim is false. No urban renewal project will be completed before 2016, I mean 2026, or 2027. Recovery from the fire will have been largely completed long before 2026. Mayor Darby is hiding the fact that urban renewal would have almost no effect on fire recovery. Almost all single family and apartment housing is already rebuilt or in the process of being recovered. All viable businesses will have recovered and rebuilt or relocated long before 2026. The manufactured home park on Arnold's Road will be rebuilt without urban renewal assistance. Millions of dollars of fire mitigation grant money is available. Taking money from the fire department's budget after the Amino fire is one of the most irresponsible ideas ever proposed. Mayor Darby is trying to manipulate and misinform voters. Community members want truth and facts to help them make an informed decision. Mayor Darby falsely claims that the urban renewal money will only be spent within the Alameda Fire Burns our area, but she fails to mention the misguided plan to spend $1.1 million to upgrade the Rapp Road Railroad Crossing. This misguided project is far outside the burn scar, has nothing to do with fire recovery. The project has the potential to become another monument to Talent urban renewal mismanagement, like the roundabout to nowhere. The plan wants to spend $730,000 to extend Wagner Street to the roundabout to nowhere. This project has been an urban renewal wish list for urban renewal for over a decade and has nothing to do with fire recovery. The plan was to spend $250,000 to upgrade Winter Sage Road to two lanes. Again, nothing to do with fire recovery. Mayor Darby spoke of older Talent municipal water pipes on the radio as having been a cause of water flow problems during the fire. This claim is manipulative and a scare tactic. She knows the water flow problems were not related to Talent municipal water pipes. The $418,000 pipe upgrade project has nothing to do with fire recovery. Project after project after project has nothing to do with fire recovery. Mayor Darby understands that by 2026, all families dislocated by the Alameda fire will have fortunately settled back in Talent, a neighboring community, or elsewhere. Millions of dollars are flowing into our area to provide low-income housing projects, thankfully. Many other projects will happen without a Talent urban renewal scheme that takes millions of dollars of critical public services, including Talent's city budget. The claims that many cities have urban renewals like this plan being proposed is false. There has never been an urban renewal plan structured like this scheme in the history of urban renewal plans. Never before has there been unified opposition to proposed urban renewal plan by a school district, a county, and a fire district. This unique unified opposition is because this plan is unlike any other urban renewal plan ever proposed. This plan is bad for the community. Mayor Darby, this is an important issue. Please stop circulating misinformation to the public. Voters deserve and want truth, transparency, and facts. Please stop trying to undermine democracy.
I just want to ask one question.
Yes, ma'am.
Are you still saying that that is not the letter that you submitted? What you just read is not the letter that you submitted?
It is a shortened version. But by the way, your council rules say that you...
I didn't ask about the council rules. I asked you.
Yes.
Was that the letter that you submitted?
It's a shortened version of the letter. It's under 5 minutes. What's in the record is much longer.
Mr. Love.
Mayor Darby, the council rules say the council does
we
not.
We will discuss council rules with you. Have a seat.
All right. Thank you very much for indulging me.
I do want to point out before I go to the audience, I would invite you to find the FAQs about this project. Have a seat, Mr. Love.
Yeah.
About this project, they were vetted by the Secretary of State for factual information, and that's probably the most reliable source of any information, certainly what I rely on.
Right. Thanks, everybody. Have a good night. Thank you, Anna. Appreciate it.
Right now, the non-conforming repo is just a really high intensity right now. We're focusing on it. We do plan on bringing that before you all next meeting. And if a decision is favorable, then go through the ordinance process. So we hope that high intensity project ends sometime around July or August. If you start managing projects for Bear Creek Greenway cleanup, that will be all hands on deck as the largest project. But it will be limited to the seasons in which we can do work down there.
That is the grant that we were just awarded to do some of that work, limited in time, which can be extended.
We're exploring that. That one, RVCOG, is actually going to manage for all three of those jurisdictions.
Mm-hmm.
So that is not grant intensive for the town, fortunately. But we have applied for 1.4 million FEMA grants, which would be only city of town, and that will be a very large burden for both grant management as well as project management. And that will slowly scroll through if anyone has any specific questions.
Any other questions? Councilor Moon.
Really just a comment. I just wanted to probably say it before I say it again. I think going down a sustainable foundation was really wise, and it also it helps paint the picture, because we can say, you know, keep the shop running. But there are projects within that that can make really a difference about how the city's run, and I appreciate putting that in the context of the goals. It paints a better picture, a more complete picture. So thank you for that.
Yeah, thank you. And I'm really excited about being able to call that section out loud. So I think if we're able to make these changes, it'll be so much easier to achieve the goals in the other areas.
Mm-hmm. I will entertain the motion if you want.
I move to adopt the fiscal year 2023-24 citywide priorities.
Second.
We have a motion to adopt the fiscal year 2023-2024 citywide priorities. And a second. All those in favor? I'm sorry, any discussion? I'll just speak to the motion and thank you for all of your great work. And I was going to agree about the strong foundation. And just for me as a visual person, I love how it just ties the whole thing together, because it really does affect all of our other priorities. So thank you, Jordan. All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion carried. Thank you. Hi, item 8.2, discussion of open number to Pacific Power.
Yes, so last council meeting, City Council passed a motion directing staff to submit a open letter to Pacific Power and place an article in the Town News and Review if Pacific Power was not already Treeline USA accredited. Turns out Pacific Power is Treeline USA accredited, so I want to make sure I brought this back to you all to discuss the different actions to be taken. I will say I reached out to both Arbor Day and National Association of State Foresters, who are the two organizations that host the Treeline USA program. They share with me that there is no actual regulation. It's a non-regulatory program and does not have any penalties or any ways to submit complaints against a Treeline certified place. But they did get me in contact with the Oregon State Forester, who's down to the NBA. yet been able to stay in contact with that person. I would love to recommend, if council so chooses, to we'll send an open letter and I can change that final paragraph in my draft letter, just to point out what the true land use standards are and how they're not being met, and calling on Civic Power to uphold to their commitment to be true land use certified.
Councilor Clark?
Yeah, I think I would support that. I had a concluding paragraph, a substitute concluding paragraph, but it was talks about inquiring with the Arbor Day Foundation to understand how these errors could have been made, and the questions that you asked about, and that there really has no regulatory teeth to it. And so the language that I have here is not particularly useful, and so I think if I would trust you to come back with language that you feel appropriate, or if you want input on that, I'm happy to offer that. But this is a case of information trickling in, I still think it's worthwhile to address this. Just want to make sure we get the language right.
Yeah. And Council Clerk, I'll also recommend that we send a copy of the letter to both the National Association of State Foresters and Arbor Day as part of the process.
Great. I like that. I appreciate that. Thank you. Thank you for everyone's patience with this issue. I just want to make sure that we respond appropriately and clearly, and we're in the process of doing that.
Councilor Milne?
Yeah, I support that idea as well. I really like where you're going with this. I don't know that, I'm not sure you really needed to bring it back to the full council. I personally would be comfortable if you worked with the liaison to Urban Forestry and the mayor and came to the college that was a good letter.
I'd be happy with that, to bring that ahead of time.
And do we need a motion for that effect?
I think so.
Yeah.
I'm ready to, yes. Councilor,
do you have a motion?
Yes.
Okay. I move to direct staff to amend the letter as discussed in consultation with Councilor Clark and Mayor. And send it.
Second. We have a motion to direct staff to amend the letter as directed by Councilor Clark and the mayor, and to send it. And a second. Any discussion? All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes. All right. Moving on to new business. Item 9.1, selection of contractor for large-scale tree planting project.
Yes, so the city council received a grant to plant up to 1,000 trees at the Waterfront Trees in Burns Park. So we posted a request for proposal looking for a contractor who could both source the trees as well as plant the trees for a large-scale tree planting project. We went through the formal RFP process. We received two proposals. One of the proposals did meet the minimum qualifications, and they are within the project budget. The proposal was from Plant Oregon. And so what I'm asking for tonight to City Council is permission to contact Plant Oregon for the specific project, and we gave them the authority to be the one to execute the contract with an opportunity to see amount of
$400,000. It's wonderful, but we've got an organization so close to home that is a great fit for this RFP. I'm curious, based on this large investment in renewing and increasing our urban forestry canopy, what plans do we have to make sure the trees are watered or cared for or going to make it?
Yes. So part of the planting is that each tree will be required an irrigation place to it. The planting location is going to be Oak Valley HOA. And so they have a contract commitment they'll sign about making sure that the trees are maintained and cared for. On city property, we're planting trees that we can put water to. so that we can effectively irrigate them until they're fully established. Mountain View Estates is the other private property location, as well as Talent Mobile Estates. This grant award does have funding to pay for up to 3 years of maintenance of the trees. So that's annual pruning, mulching, and just double checking the irrigation. We didn't put that into this contract for now because there's some questions about how long the grant funds will be extended for. And it depends if they make it into this next planning budget. So if that is the case, we will look at amending the contract to also include that longer term maintenance.
Thank you. Do we have any communication so far with the Talent Mobile Estates, Mountain View Community, and the O'Reilly HOA about that expectation?
Yes.
For the trees alive and well?
Yes.
Great. Okay. Any questions? I would entertain a motion. Councilor Carmona.
I move to contract with Plant Oregon for the large-scale tree planting project and grant the city manager authority to execute the contract with a not-to-exceed amount of $400,000.
We have a motion to contract with Plant Oregon for the large-scale tree planting project and grant the city manager authority to execute the contract with a not-to-exceed amount of $400,000. And a second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes. All right. We briefly, I'm sorry, one more. Item 9.2, irrigation for trees.
Yes. If I may. So the grant from OIF includes funding to connect to existing irrigation systems with drip irrigation. So if there's an existing system nearby, correct me if I say anything wrong, the grant can be used to attach to that system and drip irrigation to the trees that they plant. There are some locations where it would be great to plant trees where there is not an existing system. And so as we're looking ahead to the budget season, I began to think about that it would be really useful and increase the impact of this wonderful grant if we allocated funding for those irrigation needs that aren't covered by the grant. New meters, SPCs, backflow valves, hardpipe, and the rest. And so what I am requesting or suggesting is that we direct staff to produce an estimate of what those costs might be in order to inform consideration of putting a specified line item into the budget that would be available for that purpose. And again, I think this grant can do a lot of things. It's very powerful, but we can make it powerful if we can get water to a few places they don't currently have.
Do we know where these areas are? Or is
that some of the areas maybe along would be along Highway 99, some of the adjacent property owners have potentially irrigation systems that we could tap into, and others do not. That's one sort of general example that I have, but I guess the work would be to look deeper into that and figure out what are those highest priority locations that lack irrigation, and what would it cost to get set up there.
So part of this request would be to come back to the council with sort of the location and a map of some sort, and then prioritize them as you stated.
Yes, and also just an estimate of the cost, you know, so that we would have an idea of what might be needed, or tiers of need, you know, highest priority locations, or I mean, I would trust staff to present that in a way that was most useful for us.
May I
have
some clarification
questions?
Sure. Yeah. Are you talking about priority planting specific to the OLED grant project locations, or throughout all of town?
I was mostly thinking about the OLED project, but maybe it's not necessary to limit it to that. If there's other locations outside of the proposed planning locations with the grant, I would be interested to see what those. I wouldn't necessarily limit it to that, I guess.
Okay. So one problem I'm facing is just time.
Sure.
With budget, we have our first budget committee meeting the May 10th, as a reminder to everyone. I have asked Mike Oxendine to already look after quotes for irrigating the new grid park. I can explore with him the idea of how we could be a quote for Highway 99. And the struggle there being with that, it also is subject to conversations with ODOT.
Sure.
Around us being able to establish a meeting within our right of ways. I'm assuming we won't mind irrigation, but we want to clear it through them. But I'm not aware of any other places with the OWEB specific grant project locations that are lacking the irrigation.
Correct, yeah.
Okay.
Correct. I guess Highway 99, now, as I run through it in my mind. Lynn Newbury is one, and Highway 99 is the other.
Okay. I can likely get very rough estimates for that consideration during our budget committee hearing for May 10th. The challenge that we'll have with lending park projects for irrigation is what our park funding is. We do have ARPA funding available, so that's for money, and ARPA could be used for projects like irrigation. So I will ask council and the budget committee to work with me to identify what our priority is for where the money is spent, for the money that we have available. So whether that's using the ARPA dollars, which are more flexible, or saving up using parks funds on the line when we have parks available for larger price tags. But I'll do my best to get an estimate by that May 10th date.
That sounds great. I'm sure that a rough estimate is going to be go a long way towards helping us understand the scale of what might be necessary.
Absolutely.
Jordan, can I ask to accompany that just to help me to have a comparison, looking at the various funding that we do have available and the different ways it could potentially be spent? That will really facilitate some question asking.
Yeah, that sounds good. And I'll give you a preview ahead of time. You know, ARPA is the most flexible money we have available right now. Parks money comes in very slowly for use in capital projects. And in this situation, we've been prioritizing irrigation over some of the parks' place priorities.
Right.
So it's just recognizing the priority change and naming which priorities we want to lend. Right.
Yeah. Any other comments? Questions? Does this require a motion?
No. If by the consensus of council is comfortable with this, I'm happy to go forward.
Okay.
Great.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, of course.
All right, then item number 10, we visited this once, but let's revisit it. Any other business or future agenda items? Councilor Palmer.
Yeah, I just wanted the chance to, I see that Gary Pendergast has left. I just wanted to say that concerns about Foss Road were very much a topic of conversation regarding safe routes to school.
which this is just the grant part where we have the grant where we have consultant helping us to identify and define potential projects. There's the ditches and everything like that make it very difficult for the buses to turn. It feels very unsafe. So it would definitely fall into and probably score very highly as a potential project for St. Francis School. But the limitations of St. Francis School is they can't do the street, sidewalks, crossings, that sort of thing. So it might have to be a combination of something else. The other things that we're talking about is traffic calming right between the elementary school and the middle school, which is also something that definitely needs doing.
I have a follow-up question about that. We had a really excellent presentation a couple of years ago on the power of tree planting to slow down traffic speed, and I'm wondering if St. Francis School ever funds increasing the urban forestry canopy.
That's a good question. I don't know if plantings would be covered. I'm trying to think of an example where they pointed to that, and I'm not able to think of one. That doesn't mean it's not okay. Mm-hmm. But their website's really good. It's something that we could look into.
Thank you. Any other questions for future agenda items? All right, we have